Good morning, Wesley. How are you this morning? We're very glad to see you. As we mentioned last time, and I'll keep mentioning, if you look in the front of you, there's a on that little pencil holder, there's a little QR code there now. And all you've got to do is take your phone, if you have a smartphone, and you got to go to picture. And then when you point your camera at that little device, a little menu will drop down at the top, and you touch that menu, and it takes you straight to the registration prayer page. We've now put registration and prayer concerns on the same page so that you don't have to go to two different places to do that. Also, if you only want to put down there your name and what service you're in, that's all that's required. For you to submit it. So if you just want to make a real quick, I'm here, that's great. If you want to do more, if you want to give us a prayer concern, all of those things are now right there at your fingertip. And all you got to do is point it at that little box. Ain't that wonderful? It's just so amazing to me. Technology just keeps on happening. And we're so glad that we can use it. So if you would, take a moment, register your attendance, let us know you're here, let us know your prayer concerns. Now, if you want to give online, you got to go to another spot. You can go to that other box that says giving online. You can do that. Or you can drop an offering in the box as you head out. You can mail it in, or you can bring it by the church office. We truly, truly, truly appreciate what you all are doing and giving that to us because supporting the church during these strange times. Are these not strange times? Amen. We have a few things going on in the life of our church, but let me remind you that this side of the sanctuary is mask recommended. So it means that once you sit down, if you wish to take it off, you can. If we ask you to wear it coming in and going out. If you want to be mask required, you need to be wearing your mask if you're on this side. But let me tell you, if you want to change, during the opening song, change sides. So we got a place for you. If you're in the wrong seat today, that way you remember. So if you're not wearing your mask, you need to be on this side. If you're on this side, we all wear our masks. So, and we continue to try to keep people safe. We are going to also have a blood drive next week. Finally, we're going to be able to bring the blood mobile out to the parking lot. So if you are so inclined, please give your blood. Also, our caring ministry group is going to start meeting again on May the 4th, and they will be meeting on the first Tuesday of the month. So we're going to start taking care of our shut-ins and doing the best we can for letting people know that we're here, and we'll try to reach out to them. So please keep that in your prayers as well. Our Women of Wesley are going to be preparing cards for college students and members of the military this week. So we're working on getting a college student list and a military list. So we may only send out a few this week and send out more later. But when we get it, we'll get it. Also, the grief group will continue to meet. And a lot of things trying to start back up. Our third Saturday Mission Day is continuing. Also, our second Saturday United Methodist Men continues. Just trying to get the whole thing going again on all different fronts. Remember, during our opening hymn, if you're on the wrong side, switch. Would you stand for our call to worship and remain standing for our opening hymn?
Rejoice, praise His precious choice.
joy it is to be able to confirm a young person into the life of our church. We did it earlier this year, and Reese wasn't able to be with us, but we're glad Reese is able to join us today, and we're going to do that confirmation service right now. The meaning of confirmation is very important that we understand, because in the service of confirmation, we receive the seal of the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so the service of confirmation within the Methodist Church is just that, confirmation of the gift of the Holy Spirit given at baptism. Just as Easter has no meaning for the world without Pentecost, so baptism has no meaning for Christians without confirmation. If then baptism is our personal participation in Easter, the death and resurrection of Christ, then confirmation is our personal participation in Pentecost, the coming of the Holy Spirit. We could say that confirmation is when the Holy Spirit is sealed into the lives of each person who freely chooses to be confirmed. It is our born-again moment. The gift of the Holy Spirit is what makes it possible to live the new life we receive in baptism. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, we put on Christ and we become children of God, a person in whom the Holy Spirit dwells, lives, and acts. As long as we cooperate with this powerful and inspirational Holy Spirit, we draw ever closer to the Father and fully enter into the life of the Holy Trinity. And so we'll ask Reese and his family and Don Spaulding, his mentor, to come to the altar area, because we have a few questions we need to ask. And then we'll ask you as the congregation to observe the screen, because you have some responses today. So listen to the responses. Blessed is the kingdom of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, both now and ever and unto the ages of ages. Reese, on behalf of the whole congregation, I ask you, do you renounce the devil, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist the devil and evil in whatever forms it presents itself? Do you confess Jesus of Nazareth as the Messiah, the Christ, the God-man who trampled down death by death and has risen from it? Will you put your whole trust in him and promise to serve him as your Lord in his church, which he is open to all? Now to the congregation, Lynn Huckabee, our lay leader, can't be with us this morning, so I'm going to ask the question for her. She'd be asking you, the whole congregation, this question. Do you reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include Reese before you in your care? It is my privilege to ask Kim Bell, who was the teacher during the confirmation class, to come and to not only ask Reese the question of the affirmation of faith, which is the Nicene Creed, but for us all to join in with him as an affirmation of our own faith as well. So, Kim, would you lead us?
Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the only begotten, begotten of the Father before all worlds, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, of one essence with the Father, by whom all things were made,
who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate, and suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets, and I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church, I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come.
Amen. Thank you so much. I'd like to ask you all to come and join us here at the altar. Remember, each time I apply the make the cross on his forehead, we'll all say, when I say the seal of the gift of the Holy Spirit, then we all say amen. And we'll do that three times, so remember. The seal of the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The seal of the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The seal of the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may kneel. Lord our God, bless your servant, Rhys Jordan, and visit and confirm within him your Holy Spirit, that as he goes forward into his years, that he may send up glory to you all the days of his life. Defend him with your heavenly grace, and by your Holy Spirit, confirm him as a true disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you stand? There is one more question we need to ask you, and that is, will you support the church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? We welcome you officially. I'll shake your hand gingerly. He broke both wrists, so he's still recovering. So we're glad to be able to do that. Join me in the closing. Glory to you, O Christ our God. Glory to you. Glory to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. May Christ our God have mercy on us and save us. You may return to your seats. What an honor and a blessing to be able to do that today. Let us pray. Eternal and loving Heavenly Father, your Son, our Savior, has promised that you will grant to all the grace that we need if we will but ask. And so, dear Lord, we ask you for the following graces in our lives and ourselves and all who join with us in worship this day. First, we pray that you would enlighten us, that we may know the immense and infinite goodness of your holiness. Help us to see the deformity of our own sin, that we may humble ourselves and confess our sin before you. Help us to know the love that you have for us, that from this day forward, we may be grateful for your goodness and mercy. Above all, be grateful for your forgiveness. Secondly, give us a firm confidence in your infinite mercy, that we may receive the pardon from our sins, that we might experience the glory of paradise. Grant us your great love, that we may desire nothing other than eternal life with you in glory. Thirdly, we beg of you perfect resignation to your will. Help us to accept with tranquility whatever you allow in our lives. We offer ourselves entirely to you, that you may do with us whatever you please. You alone give us the light and the strength to do your will. Give us the spirit of true humility and meekness, that we may accept with peace and even with joy all that comes our way. Give us the grace to obey your commandments and follow your will. Give us an upright heart in all that we do, so that we desire nothing but to glorify you. And so today, bind us together in your love as we pray the prayer that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ taught us to pray and say together: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would you remain seated as we sing our hymn of prayer?
Consume all my darkness, shine on me, shine on me.
Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory.
Yeah. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. You know, I often find that when I walk with one of my very best friends, that we go many, many steps without saying a single word. I also find that sometimes when I'm praying to God, that I start my prayer and then I think, what am I going to pray about? You know? So there's a five-finger prayer that I like to remind everyone of every once in a while. So if you don't mind, put your hands together like you're praying. However, do not close your eyes. And you'll notice the first finger that's closest to you is your thumb. That finger reminds us to pray for those who are close to us, like our family, like our moms and dads, grandmas, grandpas, brothers, sisters, aunts and uncles, and so on. Next, you have your index finger. That is often used for pointing, right? So we pray for those who point us in the right direction, like our school teacher at school, like our Sunday school teacher here at church, and our pastor. Next, you have the tallest finger on your hand. That finger reminds us to pray for the leaders of our country, like our president and our government, and also for the leaders in our hometown. Next, you have your ring finger. Your ring finger is the weakest finger on your hand. Ask Miss Bobby. She'll tell you that when you play piano, that's a weak finger. She'll tell you it's true. This reminds us to pray for those who are sick or hurting. And next, you have the smallest finger. That finger in the Bible, it tells us that we ought not think too highly of ourselves. It reminds us to pray for ourselves. So the next time you go into prayer and you can't think of anything to pray about, remember the five-finger prayer. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for prayer. It is good to have a friend to talk to, but even friends sometimes have trouble thinking of something to say. Help us to remember the five-finger prayer, to remember those who need our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If there's any children that like to go next door with me, you are more than welcome.
To ask Pat Green to come and share our scripture lesson for this morning. And this morning we're going to be reading from Mark's Gospel, chapter 16, beginning with verse 1. And since it is a reading from the Gospel, would you please stand for a reading from the Gospel?
Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked upon, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be afraid," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go and tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God.
You may be seated. Thank you, Pat. Christ is risen. Amen. Don't forget, we're in the season of Easter for 40 days. We're looking at various things that happened. So even the passage of Scripture we're looking at kind of goes back to that morning, but we'll be looking at it from different angles. So I don't think it's going to come as any surprise when I say that Wesley United Methodist Church has been blessed with many strong women in our church. Amen? Men, you all need to say amen. Amen? All right. For example, we now have, wow, the women of Wesley with their new emphasis on study and mission and of course, service. We're also blessed to have dedicated women who head up various ministries within our church, like caring ministries, like Backpack Buddies, the majority of our Sunday school teachers, some of our Sunday morning and Sunday evening leaders, and more. In addition, we have the church, in our church, we have the women who are involved with Celebration Women's Ministry, and they're going to be having their national conference this week. One of our very own is the leader of that conference, Kim. Thank you so much for all your hard work. We are blessed, truly blessed with amazing women in our church, which makes this Sunday of the myrrh-bearing women, I think, all the more important, especially when we remember that these women who went to the tomb with oil and spices to anoint the body of Christ were the first witnesses of the salvation of the world. They were the first to hear the words of the angel, "He is risen, he is not here, go tell the disciples." Without those strong women, who knows how things would have unfolded. Now, these women were obviously, they obviously did not expect for the tomb to be empty. They were surely brokenhearted, afraid, and terribly disappointed that their Lord had been killed in such a horrific manner, which makes it all the more remarkable that they had the strength to, and the courage, I'd like to say, to offer one last act of love, to anoint the body and prepare it for burial. Just imagine the risk they were taking. Publicly identifying themselves with the Lord at his crucifixion, and now they were going to the tomb to one who had been executed as a traitor. With a courage that could only be born out of love, they must have put aside all of their obvious concerns about their own personal safety. And as they did so, these women, Mary, the mother of God, Mary Magdalene, the other two Marys, Joanna, Salome, Martha, Susanna, and others whom the church tradition hold to be there but do not name. We don't know their names. By the way, the only way you can see that long list of women who came to the... You remember there were only two or three mentioned in what Pat shared with you a few moments ago. The only way you can see that list is if you put all the gospel accounts together, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, plus you add a little bit of church tradition. Now, despite any controversy about who these women might be, it is clear that these women first received the greatest news ever to be announced on the planet, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. They were the first. Now, you may not also realize that the angelic proclamation of Easter came also to the Virgin Mary, who was also the first one to hear the proclamation of his impending birth. Again, if we don't know some church tradition, you might not realize her presence in this event, because the Bible, as you heard just a few moments ago, only refers to her as Mary, the mother of James, who tradition tells us was the stepbrother of Jesus. So the Virgin Mary is mentioned there in Scripture. It's an often overlooked part of the tradition of our church, especially among Protestants. And in many ways, our salvation comes to us through a woman who gave herself completely to the will of God. Oh, if only we were more like her. If only we were more like these women, these courageous women. We have a lot to learn from these women. For if we want to live the new life of our Lord's victory over death and corruption in all of its forms, we must do as they did by serving our Lord in humility and love despite the cost. Let me say that again. if we really want to live the life of our Lord that he has brought to the world, we do so by serving our Lord in humility and love, despite what it might cost us. And guess what? We have no lack of opportunity to serve Christ, his body, the church. And this is especially true now as we attempt to wake the church back up from its long COVID sleep. Out of love for Christ, let us answer the call to serve him as we need, as whatever he needs in his body, the church, whatever service we can render. And of course, we do not just encounter the Lord only within the visible boundaries of the church, do we? For every human being is an image of God, an image of Christ, especially the poor and the needy and the miserable. Remember the words of our Lord? What did he say? That if we care for the least of these in our society, we care for him. But don't forget the other half of that. If we neglect them, we neglect him. It is important for us to remember that the myrrh bearers did not disregard Christ's body in the tomb, and neither should we disregard the Lord's body that is hungry and sick and poorly clothed and abused or otherwise suffering in the world, especially those right here in our own backyard. And so on this Sunday of the myrrh-bearing women, it is clear that holiness is not a matter of earthly power or prestige, is it? Those righteous women did not count for much at all, even in their own time. How do we know this? Well, even the male disciples disregarded their preaching about the resurrection. The new day of God's reign ushered in by Easter is a passing over from spiritual blindness, self-centeredness, and dominance to love, selfless service, and true humility before God and all who bear his image. By the way, that's everybody. And so here's the bottom line. If we want to participate even now in the glory, this glory of Easter, if we want to embrace the power that is beyond the power of this age, we must follow the example of those courageous and loving women who risk their lives out of love for our Lord. Yes, it is clear that a life of courageous love for our Savior is not going to be easy, is it? But you knew there'd be one of those, didn't you? It is the only path that will lead us to behold and even personally participate in the good news of his resurrection on the third day, which after all is what this season of Easter is all about, is it not? So what's it going to be? Will we continue to love only those who love us? Or will we allow our love to be a courageous love that allows us to experience the true power of Easter? What's it going to be? As always, the choice is entirely yours. Amen? Let us pray. In the glorious light of the resurrection, O Lord, we are so grateful that we can bow before you today, and in gratitude and worship, we can come to you in spirit and truth. On this second Sunday after Easter, we are mindful of the many amazing women who served in our church. They remind us of the myrrh-bearing women and show us how to serve you and love you. We need their example, Lord. Because all too often our self-centeredness makes us spiritually blind and causes us to miss the Passover of Easter and its call to a selfless service and true humility. Help us, dear Lord, to be like these amazing women who, despite the risk to their own personal safety, came to your tomb to serve you and allowed the courage of their love to define their humanity. And in so doing, they became more and more like you. And so, dear Lord, we ask the same. When we love you, despite the cost, help us to become who you made us to be in the first place. Help us to live our life as a courageous love. All this we ask in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Since we did the creed a little earlier, slight change. Would you stand for our closing song? Remember, Easter calls us to serve the Lord in humility and love, despite the cost. And you are sent in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go forward into this glorious day and live in God's peace. Amen.